Scripture reading this morning comes from selected passages from Matthew 6 and 7. Matthew 6, when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we have also forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And from Matthew 7, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, it will be to the and to the one who knocks, it will be opened. That other stuff wasn't in there. Or which one of you, if his son asks him for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father, who is in heaven, give good things to those who ask him? This is the word of the Lord.
This is going to be a conversation, and hopefully a quick conversation. I've shared with you about a month or so ago, a little over a month, like just struggling. I said, there's something missing, Lord. There's more. It's got to be more. And as you heard me the last time I spoke, is that I identified directly, and I call this like a fresh being filled with the Holy Spirit or something along those lines. You can pick the title and the name. And that's how, and I asked our elders for some latitude, like coming briefly here, but staying away. And good thing we had a guest minister. So I had a lot of time on my own, family and all, just to be. And this time was to reflect, but mostly to search. And I have so many sources that I can refer you to. A lot of the things you hear today, they come from different sources, different people. But I used mostly audible stuff that I could put my headphones on and do menial things and walk and work and whatever. And then just immerse myself, listening and praying and all. Okay, so it's been like a long 30 days plus. And a lot of things came to my mind. I'm going to call them revelations. Revelation because not that something new that God gave me, like none of that. Revelation like a veil was lifted. It's almost like I knew it all along, but was my head or my eyes or my thinking was just covered. And I remember growing up. I told you about the years away from God growing up, but I remember my days as a child. I was raised in a Christian home, very strict, if you remember. And I remember our vacation Bible schools. And in Brazil, where I was born, there was this vacation Bible school song that says, and I started saying in Portuguese, a lot of people knew this song. I'm not going to sing, I'll just translate the words. And it says, because back way back when, go back, right? It says like, even though I do not march in the infantry, you guys, so you remember already? That's the one. Even though I don't ride on cavalry, and even though I'm not an airman, one thing I am, I'm a soldier of Jesus. Right? And he would repeat, soldier of Jesus I am. So now let me ask you, let's have this conversation. When you think of a soldier, what image comes to your mind of God? A general. How do you position yourself before a general? I say, attention, right? Yes, sir. Command, tell me. So what do you think my image growing up of God was? He's my general. He comes and goes without announcing, but when he comes, all attention. Tells me what to do, or tell the captains and the majors and colonels and lieutenants and sergeants, whatever, and goes away, comes back. Powerful, distant. Then, along those wonderful vacation Bible school lessons and Sunday schools, I learned about the narrow way and the broad way. You know what, narrow gate and wide, the wide. You guys remember that? Let's review it. He says that the gate to heaven is narrow. Wide is the gate to perdition. So at our church, as a good church, he had a lot of pictures in the fellowship hall. And this picture portrayed there was a narrow door, and then a Christian would go through that door. And throughout his life, narrow ways, all the way to heaven, very somber, very quiet walk, no noise, very well behaved. And eventually there was a party in heaven. And then right alongside it was this wide gate, this wide way, this broad way, and people having all kinds of fun, parties, and joy, and noises. Of course, at the end, there was hell for them. So when I saw that picture and heard that lesson, what image of God, of my life walking with God, do you think was formed in my mind? That a Christian life is what? Boring. Strict. You can't show expression. None of this. So the veil was beginning to lift, because as soon as I saw this, I said, wait, we got a problem here. When we think of Christ in the New Testament and what he came to do, if I were to ask you and ask ourselves, what did Christ come to do? And I say, of course he came to die on the cross for us, for you, for me. Of course he came to take our sins away. Of course. Of course he came to give me his righteousness, mean all his goodness is mine now. That's true. He came to destroy the works of evil. That's true. He came to expose the demon or the Satan to ridicule. Yeah, it is true. Colossians says that, right? And he came to give me life. And he came to establish God's kingdom on earth. But when I try to look again at the New Testament, Jesus' life, his ministry, something struck me. All these truths, reasons why he came, they become secondary to one primary point. And I believe that the veil was left, even though it's perhaps known to many, even you, that I realize that Jesus came to reveal God as Father. All the others, true, but as a Father. Not only as a Father, but as a good and perfect Father. Not general, even though powerful. Not a narrow that wants to take away or steal away the joys of life, but somebody who, as a father, wants to me to see me in delight. Why would he have all these other pictures in our minds? I mean, I'm trying to understand. I mean, just overall. And this journey led me to think that, of course, like when I think of Moses, right? Great man of God. Of course, the law. But again, it's fire and the thunder and all this separation and fear and all. So, okay, law is good. So God is a commander giving laws and I'm supposed to obey. When I think of Elijah, right? The prophet, great name. But also, yes, very, very, very instrumental. God, men of God in their seasons, they were everything God wanted them to be. But again, Elijah is the one who calls people to repentance. Choose the way you're going to follow, right? So perhaps that's what feeds this image of us, of God, as being the way. So Jesus comes and he changes it. How did he change it? Change it. I was trying to say, listen, all the things I learned, I started writing here and then add and so on. Somebody said this, someone else said that and this, and I believe the Holy Spirit used it in my life. But I believe that Jesus came to reveal this in a couple of ways. The first way was by modeling his relationship with the Father himself. Jesus says constantly, The Father and I are one. He says constantly, I don't say anything that he hasn't said. He constantly says, I only do what he does. So it's that intimacy. As a father, when a child comes, especially a boy to a dad, says, listen, I want to follow your profession. I know any profession for our children are great, but that gives you such a joy because it says the child delights in me, in what I do. You can relate to that, right? So just give an idea. But Jesus is saying, me and the Father are one. And he says it over and over again. Spends countless hours with the Father. Sometimes he would start like late in the afternoon, stay all night. Just this conversation, the intimacy. Not a heavy time of prayer, but a conversation, getting to know and being known by the Father. So this is something that touches, that Jesus is passing on to us. It's so critical, this idea of this one with the Father, that Jesus, before he goes to the cross, he prepares the disciples. He says, I will not leave you, what? Orphans, meaning I've been as the Father to you in this time. You see me, you see the Father. So I am, this is not going to stop. The Holy Spirit, now that, like me, the Holy Spirit will come and continue this relationship. So you're not going to be left orphans anymore. Never. You're going to be with me. So he continues that. So he comes by modeling it. But he also comes in a different way. Because once I start understanding God as a Father in this way, do you know what happened to me? I began to relearn stories of the Bible, events, in a different light. I'll give a couple of examples. For instance, remember the blind man from Jericho? You remember? Jesus is passing through his final week on earth. There's this blind man by the roadside. Remember the blind man starts yelling. He hears that Jesus is coming, right? And he starts yelling, right? Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And then people all around him says, yeah, call him. Maybe he will stop for you. Is that what they did? What did he do? Quiet, stop it. And what did he do? He cried even more. And then he cried so much or so loud. What did Jesus do? Stopped. For the longest, I saw here this condescending, divine person taking time to take care of a needy one. Almost like I should care for people in need. That might be true. But I was able to see something more, and I hope you get it. Because what I saw was a father who sees a child in need. And it is within his power to do something about it. And he stops. And as he approaches, he says, what would you want me to do for you, son? That I may see that. And he does it. I don't know about you. That changes everything for me. Another illustration. Do you remember the woman caught in adultery? They bring her to Jesus. Men with rocks in their hands, they're ready to stone her. But before that, they call Jesus in and says, Jesus, she was caught in adultery. What do we do? They don't set a trap for him, right? And Jesus tells them what? Whoever has no sin, cast the first stone. And then what does he do? He kneels down. Starts writing on the sand, right? On the dirt. Of course, nobody knows what he wrote. But that moment, the atmosphere was changed from hate to grace. And little by little, the Bible says, from the eldest to the youngest, right? Everybody start leaving. Eventually, Jesus and an adulterous woman stay. There he is in open place. Son of God, perfect man, holy man, and an adulterous woman. But he couldn't care less what that looked like to those around him. Do you know why? Because at that point, was not somebody that was morally wrong that needed to be fixed. but there was a father next to a daughter with an opportunity to restore her. That changed everything. There's not a daddy in this world. If he had a daughter that could be restored, that he could not, he would not act this way. And I thought of his teachings as well. There's so many people, but I thought of his teachings as well. Do you remember when the parable of the prodigal son? This one father has two sons. The youngest comes, asks for the inheritance, and leaves, right? And then we are told that he went and he wasted it all, right? You probably know this, right? And I did not invent this, but there's a book about this as well. But you know that the word prodigal means using your resources without limit. That's a long definition to prodigal. So it's not necessarily bad. The idea of prodigal son is because he wasted, he used irresponsibly all his resources. Hold on to that thought. There, you know, remember the parable? He's there and he wastes, irresponsibly uses it all. He's hungry. His friends leave him. He eats the pig's food. And then he says, what am I doing here? I'm going to go back. My father's workers have better than this. And he rehearses a confession, which was a true one. Father, I've sinned against heaven, and I sinned against you. I know I'm not worthy of being your child again, but take me as one of your employees, right? You remember the rehearsal. And he comes, the parable goes, and then as he approaches the house, where is his father? Where? At the gate. And then as he sees the son far away, what does the father do? He runs. Picture. It was not honorable for elderly men to run in public. And especially with the way they dressed. It was risky. But he runs to him. And once he finds him, what does he do? The son begins to say it. Father, I sinned against heaven. What does the father do? He kisses him, embraces and kisses him, and call out orders. Bring him new clothing. Bring him a ring for his finger. Bring him sandals. Call out all the kitchen people and all the people involved in preparing food. Prepare a banquet. This whole celebration. So Jesus is saying, listen, this is God, a good and perfect Father. Okay. I'm hard, people. Okay. I'm very stubborn. If you know me long, you know that. So even with my Father in heaven, I need more than just like a few stories. Ken read for us portions of Matthew 6 and Matthew 7. I just want to refer you to a couple of the verses that he read. If you have your Bible, if not, just listen. Verse 7 on chapter 6. My version says this. When you pray, you hear that? When you pray, do not keep on babbling on like pagans. For they think they will be heard because of their many words. Another version says, stay away from vain repetitions when you pray. When you talk to your dad, don't keep repeating the same thing, okay? Would you agree that that's a good translation? Okay? Speaking to your dad, don't start repeating stuff over and over again, right? Say it once. Look at verse 8. Do not be like them who keep repeating. For your father, complete the verse for me. For your father knows what you need before you ask him. Oh, see, I think I got it. Let's see if I got it. See if you agree with me. I think it's like this. Child is hungry. Dad, I'm hungry. How many times does a child have to say that? One time. So you have a need, your father knows. Tell him. That's why the prayer, Lord's Prayer, that comes right after, right? He says, give us this day our daily bread. Ask, tell the Lord your needs. Once. Because he's your father. The rest of the chapter talks about lilies and the birds and all those things. The idea is emphasizing, saying, he cares for you. With me? Look at chapter 7 now. He also read. Matthew, chapter 7, verse 7. So help me out here. I'll say it and then you complete the verse. Ask and it. Come on, everyone. Ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and you. Knock and. Okay. Let's do exegesis here. Wow, man. No, none of that. Let's understand this. There's three action verbs, right? That much we need to know. All a constant, a present that's constant. Keep on asking. Keep on seeking. Keep on knocking. You got that? Because you will find it. You're going to find it. You're going to get an answer. And it shall be given unto you. Okay? Ask, seek, and knock. So I ask you, is there a contradiction? Chapter 6 says, ask your father, how many times? Once. And chapter 7 says, because if you notice, the rest of the verse says, how much more your father give you good things, right? Give your children good things. How many times are we supposed to ask in chapter 7? Keep asking until you receive. So, is that a contradiction? I think there's something here. I learned that only not Jesus came to reveal that not only God is a good and perfect Father, but the God is concerned and will meet my needs. But he will also fulfill the dreams that he's created me for. Let me labor this a little bit more. There are things within me, within you, that are so unique and precious that you were created to fulfill, to achieve, to be. That when you find life is heaven on earth, a fulfillment beyond description, God-given. He's saying, keep on dreaming, keep on asking, keep on seeing. Don't give up. I place you there, and I will see you through. Are you with me? Needs, dreams. Okay. Thank Lord, I got it. I heard an illustration and I thought, that was me. Someone was told that they had inherited 10 acres of a beautiful land. Some like lost known relative they never knew existed, died and left them this big 10 acre property. It was beautiful. So this person was brought to that property. And it was so huge that they got to an elevated point, and the person that was showing the inheritance says, you see that tree all the way there, as far as your eyes can see? That's the boundary on this side of your property. You see that beautiful lake all the way there? That's also yours. You see this? It's yours. You see that? It's yours. Beautiful. Of course, quickly went to the meaning, which is God in Christ has given us everything. Everything. So see, the riches, sitting on the heavenly realms and all, it's yours. But I found myself doing what, you know? Standing there for my entire life on that one position, admiring what I have, but afraid of taking one step of faith and start exploring what he has given me. Do you see that? Back to the narrow gate and the wide people. We are not meant to live these miserable lives with our dreams not fulfilled. The narrow gate, what he means is this: there's no other name through which we might be saved. It would be a crime that God would have committed if there were another way besides Jesus. That's why the gate is narrow. Matthew 7 gives one verse to it. This idea of a messed up life and sad life and somber, looking down, defeated, this is us. We miss something critical. The cross is essential to the gospel. You cannot get to God without the cross. His death on the cross. But listen, Jesus did not stay on the cross. He was resurrected. And you and I live through him. We are meant to live our lives in the power of the resurrection. The Bible says the same power that was in Jesus resurrecting from the dead is at work in you and I today. Say, son, the world is yours. Ask. Seek. Knock. Keep on. I'm a good and perfect father, and I care for you. I care for your needs, but I care for your dreams. I did not mean for you to live this life like a survival mode. Remember I said to you I was hard? So I'm thinking, okay, I'm a good Presbyterian, and how about the sovereignty of God? He's sovereign. What do you mean I can't ask him anything? Someone had a good explanation for that. Where I said, oh man, I never thought about this one. Do you know what the explanation was? Let's relive the first miracle of Jesus. What was the first miracle that Jesus performed? Water into wine. It was a wedding, right? Okay. Jesus with the disciples and Mary, they go to the wedding, right? He gets there, and then the wine runs out. And then what does Mary do? Son, there's no more wine. So Jesus is a good son. What does he tell Mary? Woman, what does this have to do with me? Man, that was rough, right? He says that, right? Now think with me. What did I say at the beginning? Jesus never said a thing that the Father had not spoken, right? True? Yes. He said that. I only say what the Father says. So when Jesus is telling Mary, that this is not the time. Whose will is he expressing? You with me? You ready to go become, okay. So, stay with me here. See if you make that connection. Mary, immediately, the one full of grace, highly favored, what does she do? She listens to Jesus, right? He said no. What does she do? She called the people. Which means what? As if Jesus had said yes, right? I'll take care of it. Do you see that? She totally, a child left out what the Father said no, and she pursues it. Asking, seeking, knocking, right? What did Jesus do next? Woman, I told you no. Is that what he does? What did he do? He tells the servants to get the water, fill the jars, and so on. So, just a guess for you, right? Just throwing out there. I think Jesus inside, before he told the servants what to do, he looked up and says, Dad, I guess we're changing the plans, right? We are changing the plans. He just said, this is not my time. But the favor, the cry of a child changed the will of the Father. Don't go crazy here, Presbyterians of CCP. Think with me. What did I learn? What I learned is this. That my dreams as a child are included in my Father's sovereign will. That's why he tells me, ask me, seek, knock. Okay, now I'm going to surrender, right? Okay, Father, I'm ready to start living my dreams unafraid. No, I need it more. So, one verse, John 14:13, I'll read it for you. It says, Jesus say, and I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. So he's saying, listen, ask me, so my Father will be glorified, your Father will be glorified. Okay, so now I got it, right? Okay, so I'm thinking, and so on, and during those days, I was, like I said, I was doing many handy things. And I could see, I already knew this. The Lord said to me, Renato, I'm going to work with you. You're going to walk with me in a part of your life that you've never done before. This is not information. This is revelation. I'm lifting a veil. Understand me as a father. Ask me. One of the things that we were doing, like I had help, but on this day I was alone. We were working like around the pool. And we changed the filter. So the filter was all done, but then something needed to be redone. Those of you plumbers look like there's a lot of unions, right? You need those things that you connect the pipes and all. So there was a unit, PVC pipes for the pool. And the instruction said I needed to open the union so I could reach another part that was critical for what I needed to do. And he says, only tighten by hand. So I knew he was only tightened by hand. The person who did it was a plumber. So I says, no problem. So I come and I need to untie it. But it's hard. And I can't. And I'm very strong on my hands. I can't. So I go in the garage, I get this biggest wrench. And I come and I gingerly first, but then I go and I try one time and tell me this sun is hot and that I'm trying and nothing moves. I said, wow, man, I can't do what I need to do and this is, try it again, nothing. Do you know what came to mind? Son, ask me. Do you know what I thought? If I pray to my Father and then it doesn't happen, he's going to be embarrassed, and I'm going to be embarrassed. I mean, I don't want to take a chance. Are you like that? Eventually, I give in and says, Father, I know this is silly, stupid, I'm here. Could you help me untie this? And I still have the wrench in my hand. Lord, I need to unscrew this. Dear ones, I don't know what happened. I dropped the wrench on purpose. And I went with one hand, and the thing came off. The good, faithful preacher that I am, do you know what I think? Well, I loosened it with my wrench before. Okay. I battled that thought. The union is loose. A few days later, still at home, Claudia calls me and says, Amor, we got a problem. The garbage disposal in the sink, and the sink had flooded, and the water, the dirty water got all in the dishwasher. It's a mess. Can you fix it? So I come and do all the things that you know, to call Elder, do, what do I do? He says, take this and do that, take the curved thing, whatever, from the bottom, and did it all. Nothing. And it was so bad that the water was leaking through the disposal, right through, right in the middle. I never seen anything like this, right? So I called Edgar's brother because he works on this as well. Guess we're going to have to replace this, right? So when can you come? Well, it's Wednesday. It's only Friday as well. Claudia, we're going to just let this, let's, don't look at the sink. Just leave it there. Don't worry about it. And right there, I as I'm struggling there now, I'm thinking, what am I doing? I says, Lord, you don't care for those things. You care for big things. Son, will you ask me? I might even have caught myself looking around to see if anybody was looking. But I says, Lord, can you unclog this thing? It did. Go home, go to my home. There's no leak in my ear. I prayed. He's just like, Pastor, I prayed and it's working. We don't need you no more. So, okay. So Claudia has been the only one that I've been like sharing more details, right? So I think we are onto something here. I have a father. We have a father that cares for my needs and care for my dreams. Even during these days, we have been new groups are showing are beginning to open here in the Brazilian Portuguese area, speaking area, Newark, which is great. This even this vacation Bible school, I had an opportunity to drive the overflow kids. Like we couldn't fit in the van, so it's been great. But we have in these meetings, and this Friday was another meeting. Was at the house. It was a visitor for the first time. She was here in the Portuguese service today. With her permission, I spoke, and then I want to speak now. I didn't tell them none of that. You're the first ones to hear this. But there we were. And I asked, almost at the end, is there anybody here that has a need for prayer? And she said, first time visitor, not a member of any church or raised a Christian. She says, I have this neck problem here, this pain that even to the touch and to the movement, it's been bothering me. And I've done everything and it doesn't go away. Do you know what went immediately inside to me? Ask me. I confess to you that with fear and trembling, I asked my Father in heaven. I knew he could take care of silly stuff like a drain that's not working or a union. But now I'm asking in front of other people. And I did ask him. We prayed. Then I asked her. Because she said it can't even touch. She showed before. How is it now? And she said, it's gone. And she was here today. And I prayed not because of the miracle, but because the question is, what kind of father is this? That cares for a union, for a clogged drain, and for a person's need. I'm beginning to realize that many of us, for so long, we live with an idea that God is like the director of an orphanage. As long as you have 3 meals a day and a bed to sleep in, you're fine. I want you to know today and begin a journey that He's way more than that. He is a good and perfect Father that loves you, that loves me, will meet our needs, and will fulfill His God, give His own dreams that He's giving us. So why is it so hard? Many of us, because we've been scarred by the images we've been taught early on. I think people meant well. I'm sure they meant well growing up. They wanted me to be a good soldier of God. I can see the concept. But my father is way more than a general. I knew they wanted to talk about the narrow gate because they didn't want to cheapen the gate. Yes, the cross is essential. There's no other name. But we messed up in the process. So it might be hard for you as it's been for me. So I ask. Seek, knock. But it also might be because so many of us had either did not have fathers or have had some very bad modeled to relate to. I can only promise you this. I cannot take away those memories. But I can promise you that my Father in heaven will bring healing on your life for those times. And will allow you to know him as the good and perfect Father that he is. Ask. Seek. Knock. I want to come back in 2 weeks and tell you a little bit more about this. I'm not prepared. We're not prepared to do this in English yet. But in Portuguese this Thursday, we're going to begin like a 7-week exploration of practical. God is Father. We as his children. Father that's good and perfect. And then we already have plans. We're going to multiply it into English as well. Because I know that the day when our church, when all of us are living this reality that God intended for us to live through Christ, there is no way that the community around us, our families in our communities, will not be transformed by the amazing goodness of this good and perfect Father that we have. And they will be drawn to Christ as well. Think on it. Dream on it. Don't be as stubborn as I am. Go a little easier. Believe more. Be like a child. You have a good and perfect Father. There's a song that we sing here a lot, right? And it says, the Father is good, and I am your child. It's early, so can we sing that song? Will you stand with me?